programma Vespro con un video. Salve Titan, biblioteca classica. Publius Vidius Naso, poeta romanus et fragilissimus narrator, fabularum metamorphoseam. Ante diem tertium vecimum calendas aprilis natus est. Ergo, ante nomen dies. Celebramus atque, eius mortem, ante duumilli annos, anno domini duodecimo, vel septimo decimo. Hodie laudamus, ovidi vitam et carna, cum sermone, lectione, musica, pro latri librorum, libro mensis, cibo vinocque, quibus ipso videos probatur. I was entertaining the idea of an entire program in Latin. Because I was very inspired by someone who gave a tour of the Prado Museum in Madrid in Latin and did it so beautifully. However, since there are also non-Latinists in the audience, that may not work as well. But for you Latinists, there will be more Latin, real Latin, all it's Latin later in the program. So again, welcome to celebrate an evening with Ovid. Not that we really need an excuse to celebrate the Roman poetry, but if we wanted one, this year or possibly last year is the 2000 year anniversary of Ovid's death. It is uncertain whether he died in the year 17 or 18. But even if he were in 17, it's still early in the year. Also, his birthday was supposedly on March 20th, so just a few days ago. So we are celebrating, and we're celebrating with a program that we hope he will find both entertaining and informative. Beginning with Dr. Bridget Langley from the UC Classics Department, who will give a presentation on Ovid's life and work, especially the Metamorphoses, the fantastic tales of transformation, often from human to other animal form, to plant form, to minerals, etc. Followed by Dr. Colin Shelton, also from the UC Classics Department, who will read from the Metamorphoses, the story of Narcissus, the young man in love with his own reflection. It is a story filled with sadness, but also humor, kind of dark humor, almost burlesque at times. And of Echo, the nymph, the young woman who falls in love with Narcissus. But since he has only eyes for himself, poor Narcissus, poor Echo, wastes away, leaving only the echo of her voice behind. And then, of course, there is the omnipresent blind seer Tiresias, who has predicted it all. And of course, he has his own special metamorphosis. Dr. Shelton will read in Latin, in verse, and in translation, interpretation, by modern English poet Ted Hughes. He chose that particular translation in order to connect with the second portion of our program that celebrates the afterlife, the reception of Ovid's work, which has been quite significant from the Middle Ages and the Renaissance. Inspiring countless writers, artists, and composers in the form of a music performance featuring Yoshi Unoya, a virtuoso on oboe from CCM. Of the modern English composer Benjamin Britten's Six Metamorphoses After Ovid, presented by a resident Benjamin Britten scholar, the head of the CCM library, right above us, Jenny Doctor. The evening will conclude with refreshments that Ovid and his Roman contemporaries might have enjoyed. In my Latin introduction, I did also mention wine, because I was hoping that we would be able to serve wine, especially from the Andalus region, Ovid's work. But unfortunately, because we are a public university, with students attending, that was not possible. So, here I would like to ask you to use your imagination. The non-alcoholic wine we will be serving, I gather, is from a booth store, even if the uncertain information wrong. But tonight is all about fantasy, right? Fables, transformation. So how about if we transform in our minds to a multiple channel of Abruzzo, which is the principal nine of Abruzzo. By the way, for those of you who are not so familiar with Ovid, I don't want to push this fairy tale analogy too far. There is quite a bit of wisdom and ingenuity, although sometimes quite disturbing in Ovid. So I mean, they're not fairy tales for children exactly, although the story of Narcissus and Echo, I think, is quite wild. I also wish to welcome you, those of you who are not familiar with our library, to the John Miller Learning Classics Library, named after the man in the portrait behind you. He was professor of Latin paleography here from 1900 to his death in 1921. And it was his personal library of some 3,500 volumes that formed the basis for our modern library. And some of those volumes you can actually see in the display case there, including the exact copy of the Egyptian Book of the Dead, Burnham is holding in his lap in the portrait. The couple above me are Louise Taft, niece of President William Howard Taft, and her husband William Semple, who was professor of classics and chair of the department from 1921 upon the death of Burnham to 1950. The couple has supported the department and the library in countless ways, but perhaps most significantly by funding virtually all the library's acquisitions. The minutes of the UC Board of Trustees are filled with notes about Professor Semple supporting another professor who was instrumental in building our library's collection, and after whom the entire building is named, Carl Bacon, was professor of classical archaeology here from 1927 to 1957. He passed away in 1971. He even went on book purchasing trips to Istanbul, London, Paris, New York, and elsewhere, and he lived part of the year in Athens, where he also acquired many books for our library. Also in this room, is a display case, the one that's lit up, the wooden one, tall one, that houses an exhibition of early editions, rare editions of the works of Ovid, including translations of some other earlier Englishmen, such as John Dryden and Arthur Goldwyn. Also in that display case is a commemorative coin from Romania on loan from Professor Peter van Minnen, featuring the statue of Ovid that is in the town square of Constanța in Romania, the place of Ovid's death. Which brings me to our guest of honor, or the figure presiding over this evening, none other than Emperor Augustus himself, in the form of a head on top of that display from a UC excavation at Troy, where the UC has a long history from Carl Bacon to today. Those of you who are familiar with the fate of Ovid may feel that it's somewhat bittersweet to have Augustus presiding. And because he was, of course, responsible, right, for Ovid's exile to present-day Constanța, Tomis in Roman times by the Black Sea. We don't know the exact reason for the exile, but it was not a happy one for this urban intellectual bon vivant, and far away from libraries, I might add, for the doctor's poetas such as Ovid. However, the Metamorphoses were written before the exile, so during happier times, when Ovid, along with other learned poets, Horace, Virgil, Propertius, and others, were in the good graces of the emperor. So that's what we'll remember tonight. On the low table next to the display case is a recurring feature of the Book of the Month. And this month's book is an Elsevier edition from 1629 of the Metamorphoses by Dutch Renaissance scholar Daniel Heinsius, with an accompanied Facebook page detailing with humor the book's history by one of our many brilliant graduate students, Angelica Wiesenbarger. Since there are a few people here who have never been to this library, I want to say just a few words about it. One of our professors has referred to this library as UC's best kept secret, which I think there's a good deal of truth to. Of course, it's known among classicists, but outside of that community, much less so. And it is a remarkable library, remarkable not only for its depth and its breadth of almost 300,000 print volumes, which is huge for a classics library. I was earlier at the American Academy in Rome, which is a well-known classics library of some 135,000 volumes. École Française, which is a very important library for classicists and medievalists alike in Rome, has some 220,000 volumes. So that too is significantly smaller than our classics library. Although with a full-time staff of 14 as opposed to our 3, it is of course larger in other respects. So this library is truly unique. Also, what makes it unique is that many academic research libraries in the United States, but especially in Europe, archaeology is often separated from philology, also in separate libraries. The same holds true sometimes for ancient history, which can be housed and shelved in the world history rather than in classics. Ancient philosophy, the same thing. Often with modern philosophy rather than in classics. But here, all subdisciplines of this, the oldest of area studies, classics, span a huge area, if you think of the Roman Empire, and several millennia in time. Language, literature, art, archaeology, history, philosophy, religion, law, science, technology, papyrology, paleography, numismatics, epigraphy, etc., etc., are all contained in one library, which is unique. Also, many libraries today have split collections, so that part of the collection is located in an off-site storage facility. This is for space concerns, but also a prevailing, more and more prevailing sentiment that print publications belong better off-site, limiting students and scholars' ability to browse the collection. I don't know how many discoveries I have made that way, and I know the same is true for all the classicists here, maybe especially for philologists whose research is based on the ancient text. So this is truly a unique library which we should really cherish and support and take pride in. I was reading just 3-4 days ago that there will be a panel in the next year's annual conference of the Society of Classical Studies of the Local Institute of America on endangered libraries. Of course, in this country, they're not endangered because of wars or earthquakes or other natural disasters. By the way, those almost 300,000 volumes are on 3 huge stack floors below us, which you are welcome to browse tonight until 10 o'clock when we close, okay? Or some other time. All right, now back to Ovid. Here is Bridget Langley, who will tell us about Ovid, followed by Colin Shelton, who will read from Ovid, followed by Yoshio Noya, who will play music inspired by Ovid and presented by Jenny Doctor. Dr. Langley.
Transformations of the summer break, and for everyone else, we're waiting for opening day to herald the transformation from winter to spring in a second now. And all of this is very appropriate for Ovid, who is a poet whose life underwent many transformations, but through whose work for 2,000 years, many people have been exploring and dealing with the big changes, the exciting changes, the devastating changes in their own lives. And that's something we'll be exploring throughout the evening. So I'm here to introduce you to Ovid a little bit, let you know what kind of a guy he was. So he was born to an upper middle class family in central Italy, and he was trained to go into the law and politics, which at the time was a very respectable kind of career. But that wasn't what he wanted for himself. He had the heart and soul of a poet, so when he was supposed to be writing his proofs for law school, he would write them in verse, you know, he just couldn't be repressed. So that was the one thing he was going to do with his life. He found a sponsor and started publishing poetry as a young man. And his first works of poetry, they were love poetry. But Ovid was a bit rebellious. He wasn't publishing exactly the same kind of love poetry that everyone had been publishing before. Other love poets would dwell on how much they were suffering through feeling unrequited love. Everything they were going through to try and get the attention of their crush. Ovid doesn't take love that seriously, he doesn't take himself that seriously or relationships that seriously. So probably his most notorious poem is actually a poetic dating manual called the Ars Amatoria. So you can consult this today, you can find out where the best place to go in ancient Rome was to pick up women, how you could impress your date at a chariot race, personal grooming tips, how much hair oil is too much hair oil. So all the important questions we still want to know today, Ovid was there. A long poem to help you out back in the 3rd century BCE. He's a rebellious guy, he's a funny guy, he's a clever guy, and he kind of knows it. He doesn't take love seriously or relationships seriously, and unfortunately for himself, he didn't really take politics too seriously either. We've already been pointed to the dismembered head of Augustus over here, looming over proceedings. He was a figure who also loomed over Ovid's life. So at the same time that Ovid is writing his Roman pickup manual, Augustus is trying to reinstill Roman family values. He is passing through legislation that makes adultery illegal, that discourages casual relationships, encourages people to get married and have lots of children. So the poetry Ovid is writing is really not gelling very well with the moral reforms that Augustus championing. And as Ovid would learn, publishing this pickup manual was actually quite a dangerous move for him. A number of years after he published the Ars Amatoria, Ovid's life was completely upended. So Rebecca alluded to this major event for Ovid when Augustus banished him from Rome, from Italy, and sent him to live in Tormes on the Black Sea. As Rebecca mentioned, that's in modern Romania. Lovely town, Constanza, but to Ovid and to Augustus, that was the very edge of the world that they knew and of what they considered civilization. This was a tragedy in Ovid's life to be sent there. So what did he do? Why was he sent all this way to the edge of the world? So Ovid writes and tells us there were two reasons. The first was a con man, a poet, and the second was an error, an mistake. What this mistake was is one of the world's great mysteries. We don't know what error Ovid committed. Presumably it was a pretty big mistake. Presumably it had something to do with Augustus and the imperial family, but we don't get any of the details. The comment is more obvious. The poem, that's the Ars Amatoria. So even though he published it years earlier, that was a great excuse for Augustus to exile the poet from Rome, away from Italy, and out where no one would be able to talk to him. So here we have our irreverent, funny poet dealing with this tragic situation. He didn't have very long to say goodbye to his friends, his wife, his children, for as far as he knew, the very last time. And on that last night, as he's about to leave Rome, possibly forever, he takes the poem that he's been working on that's nearly finished, and he burns it. In his devastation, he doesn't think that he should publish it. That poem was the Metamorphoses. So luckily for all of us tonight, luckily for Benjamin Britten, Ovid had some friends who had already copied the poem, so it was sort of symbolic to throw it in the fire, but it wasn't lost with all the night that Ovid went into exile. So the Metamorphoses, as Rebecca mentioned, the name means transformations, and that's what it is. It's a long poem, a 15-book long poem, that collects together over 200 stories from Greek mythology. And the thing all these stories have in common is they all describe some kind of transformation. So, stones turning into people turning into animals or into plants, gods turning into so that they can come down onto Earth and kind of wreak havoc among the people that live there. So these stories take place in a setting that's mysterious, that's magical, very different from the world that we live in. But at the same time, these are stories that they deal with very real human experiences and very real human emotions, some of which stories you'll be hearing about tonight. So one example that you're going to hear in the music recital is the story of Niobe. So Niobe, she felt some really extreme grief, and her transformation is the story of that grief. So she watched all of her children be killed by the gods, and she was devastated, paralyzed with grief. So if you know the feeling when you're completely numb, when you can't move, you can't think, you can't even feel anything because you're so paralyzed with grief. That was how Niobe felt. She sat there and she didn't move a muscle, and gradually, piece by piece, she turned into stone. So that's the kind of very vivid, very relatable story that we tell. It's not believable, but we know what Niobe went through, and that transformation can still speak to us. And that's part of the reason that Ovid's poem has been so influential. So he didn't invent the stories that are in the Metamorphoses. These are often very, very old Greek myths that he's just telling in his own version. But Ovid's version of these stories is the version that we remember. So if you read Greek myths as a child, if you were told the stories of the Greek gods and goddesses, you were learning from Ovid. And that's good precedent for that. Throughout the 2,000 years since Ovid's death, people have been doing the same. When Renaissance painters wanted to paint Greek myth, they looked at the Metamorphoses. When early composers of opera wanted to stage classical stories, they opened the Metamorphoses too. So this is also a poem that's an artist's poem that is embedded in Western art traditions. And it's also a poem that's really about art and the power of art. It's a poem that's full of creative people creating new kinds of music, new kinds of art. It's about the power that art can have, but also how dangerous it can be to be someone creating something new and creating something powerful. So a story that maybe many of you are familiar with is the story of Arachne. So Arachne was the kind of hotshot new weaver in her community. Everyone was really into the cloths and tapestries that Arachne could make, and they were beautiful. Minerva, the goddess of weaving, heard about Arachne and she thought she was getting a little big for her boots. So Minerva has to do something about that, of course. So she comes down to Earth and challenges Arachne to a weaving contest. So the goddess and the human, they both weave tapestries, and they're both beautiful tapestries. But Arachne's is better. Arachne's looks like it's alive, like you think that the people and the gods are even moving. It's so beautiful. And Minerva sees that Arachne's tapestry is better, and she picks it up, and she hits Arachne on the head and transforms Arachne into a spider. So the spider, it can still weave, but it can't weave anything that's dangerous to the gods. And that's often the challenge that the artists and musicians in Metamorphoses face. They're creating something powerful, but there's a danger that goes with that. So hopefully you can see where I'm going with this. Ovid's a little bit like Arachne. maybe he's still there coming. He gets exiled to Tomis, and he still keeps creating. He's like that spider, right? He keeps on going. He writes a lot of poetry. He writes poems begging Augustus to forgive him. He writes poems begging his friends and family to intervene on his behalf. He writes poems begging his readers just not to forget about him. But 10 years after exile, he dies out there in Tomis. He never gets recalled. He never comes back to Rome. He never gets reunited with his family. Okay, so I'm not going to leave you on that point. So one of the reasons that meeting right now is a good time to celebrate Ovid is Ovid just had his first birthday as a pardoned man. So in December last year, the City Council of Rome came together and they voted unanimously to recall Ovid's exile. He's free, he's pardoned, Augustus can suck it. And the deputy mayor of Rome, he gave a statement about why they thought it was important to pardon a man who's been dead for 2,000 years. And he said, it is about the fundamental right of artists to express themselves freely In societies in which around the world, the freedom of artistic expression is increasingly constrained. So I think we can come together today to celebrate the work of Ovid, to celebrate its endurance against adversity and against the passage of time, but also just to celebrate our ability to come together and share poetry and share music, and to share a human connection with a poet who's 2,000 years old. So enough from me. I think it's about time we hear from Ovid. He's going to be speaking to us through the vessel of Dr. Colin.
I'm going to read to you in Latin first. So we get Ovid's own words. This is from the tale of Echo and Narcissus that we will be treating ourselves to later on. And this is the moment where the two characters meet for the first time and have the kinds of conversations you can have with an Echo.
Quoties volvi blandis accedere dictis, et mollis libere preces, natura repugnat, nec sinet, incipiat, quod sinet illa paradex expectar sons, ad quos sua verba remitat. Forte puer comitum seductus, ab agmine fido dixerat, equis ad est, et ad est, responderat Echo, hic stupet. Ut quaciem partes dimitti nomnes, voce quedi, magna clamat. Vocat illa vocantem, respicit, et brusus nur nove niente, quidquid me fugis, et potinem quod dixit verba recipit. Per stat et alter mare incetus imagine vocis, uque amus act. Nuique libentius unquam responsur sono, quae amus, retur Echo. Et verbis favet ipsa suis egressa basilio aibat, ut in icerat sperato veracchia collo. Ille fugit, fugiesque manus complexibus aufer, ante ait emoriar, quam siti di copia nostri. Reduit illa, nil, misit, siti di copia nostri. Preda latensum vis pudibunda qua frondibus ora, protegit et solis et illo vivit in antris. Sed amen aeret amor, crescuitque dolore repulsae, extenuant vigiles corpus miserabile curae. Aducitque cultem magies in aera sucus corporis omnis amit. Vox tantum ad quossa super sunt. Vox manet, ossa ferunt lapidis praxisse figura. Inde latetium vis nullocuim monte videtur, omnibus auditur, sonus est qui vivit in illa.
Let's hear what it sounds like. We'll start with One Step Back. This is a poem where stories weave into other stories. So where does this begin? One time, Jupiter, happy to be idle, swept the cosmic mystery aside, draining another goblet of ambrosia, teased Juno, who drowsed in bliss beside him. This love, male and female, is a strange business. 50-50 investment in the madness? Yet she ends up with 9/10 of the pleasure. Juno's answer was, a man might think so.
It needs more than a mushroom in your cup to wake a wisdom that can fathom which enjoys the deeper pleasure, man or woman. It needs the solid knowledge of a soul who, having lived and loved in a woman's body, has also lived and loved in the body of a man. Jupiter laughed aloud. Ha! Well, we have the answer. There is a fellow called Tiresias. Strolling to watch the birds and hear the bees, he came across two serpents copulating. He took the opportunity to kill both with a single blow that nearly hurt them, and found himself transformed into a woman. After the seventh year of womanhood, strolling to ponder on what women ponder, she saw in that same place the same two serpents, knotted as before in copulation. If your pain can still change your attacker, just as you once changed me, then change me back. She hit the couple with a handy stick. And there he stood, as male as any man. He'll explain, cried Juno, why you are a slave to your irresistible addiction, while the poor nymphs you force to share it with you do all they can to shun it. Jupiter asked Tiresias, in their act of love, who takes the greater pleasure, man or woman? Woman, replied Tiresias, takes 9/10. Juno was so angrier than is easily understandable. She struck Tiresias and blinded him. You've seen your last pretty snake forever. But Jove consoled him. That same blow, he said, has opened your inner eye like a night scope. See, secrets of the future, they are yours. When the prophetic vision awoke behind the blind eyes of Tiresias and stared into the future, the first to test how deeply he saw and how lucidly was Eurydice, a swarthy nymph of the fountain. She was kept off her feet by the river Cephisus, who rolled her into the bed of a dark pool and cast her up on the shade of a pregnant. The boy she bore, even in his cradle, had a beauty that broke hearts. She named his child Narcissus. Gossips came to Tiresias. Can her boy live long? The seer replied, yes, unless he learns to know himself. All regarded these words as a riddle, till time solved them with a strange madness. A stranger death completed the explanation. In his 16th year, Narcissus, still a slender boy, but already a man, infatuated many. His beauty had flowered, but something glassy about it, a pride, kept all his admirers at a distance. None dared be familiar, let alone touch him. A day came, out on the mountain, Narcissus was driving and netting and killing the deer when Echo saw him. Echo, who cannot be silent when another speaks. Echo, who can't speak at all unless another has spoken. Echo, who always answers back. In those days, this nymph was more than a voice. She had a pretty body, but her prattle was the same. Never anything more than the last word or two, the tail end of what she heard uttered by others, which she repeated over and over. Juno had struck her with this odd affliction. When Juno, following a tip-off, would be stalking Jupiter to catch him in some dell with a nymph, Echo made it her duty to engage the goddess in an unending rigmarole of chatter, till the nymph had pleased the god enough to be let go. Echo did this so often and so artfully, Juno, in a rage, turned on her. Your tongue has led me in such circles. Henceforth, it will have to trail helplessly after others, uttering only the last words helplessly of what you last heard. The moment Echo saw Narcissus, she was in love. She followed him like a starving wolf, following a stag too strong to be tackled, and like a cat in winter at a fire, she could not edge close enough to what singed her and could burn her. She almost burst with longing to call out to him and somehow let him know what she felt, but she had to wait for some other to speak so she could snatch their last words with whatever sense they might lend her. And so happened. Narcissus had strayed apart from his companions. He hallooed them, where are you? I'm here. An echo caught at the syllables as if they were precious. I'm here, she cried.
I'm here. I'm here.
Narcissus looked around wildly. I'll stay here, he shouted. You come to me. And
come to me,
shouted Echo.
Come to me.
To me.
To me.
Narcissus stood baffled, whether to stay or go. He began to run, calling as he ran, stay there. But Echo cried back, weeping to utter it, stay there, stay there, stay there, stay there. Narcissus stopped and listened. Then more quietly, let's meet halfway. Come. And Echo eagerly repeated it, come. But when she emerged from the undergrowth, her expression pleading, her arms raised to embrace him, Narcissus turned and ran. No, he cried, no, I would sooner be dead than let you touch me. Echo collapsed in sobs as her voice lurched among the mountains. Touch me, touch me, touch me, touch me. Echo moped under the leaves, humiliated. She hid in the deep woods from that day. Like a hurt lynx, for her any cave was a good home. But love was fixed in her body like a barbed arrow. There it festered with his rejection. Sleeplessly, she brooded over the pain, wasting away as she suffered. The petal of her beauty fading and shriveling, falling from her, leaving her voice and bones. Her bones, they say, turned into stone, sinking into the humus. Her voice, roamed off by itself, unseen in the forest, unseen on the empty mountainside. Though all could hear it, living the only life left to Echo. Narcissus had rebuffed her adoration, as he had the passionate attentions of many another nymph of the wilderness, and many another man. One of these, mocked and rejected, lifted his hands to heaven, let Narcissus suffer, and as he has made us suffer, let him like us love and know it is hopeless, and let him like Echo perish of anguish. Nemesis, the corrector, heard this prayer and granted it. There was a pool of perfect water. No shower had ever driven sheep to trample the margins. No cattle had slobbered their muzzles in it and befouled it. No wild beast had ever dashed through it. No bird had ever paddled there, preened and bathed. Only surrounding grasses drank its moisture. And though the arching trees kept it cool, no twigs rotted in it, no leaves. Weary with hunting and the hot sun, Narcissus found his pool. Gratefully, he stretched out full length. Cold and to drink, but as he drank, a strange new thirst, a craving unfamiliar, entered his body with the water and entered his eyes. With his reflection in the limpid mirror, he could not believe the beauty of those eyes that gazed into his own. As the taste of water flooded him, so did love. So he lay, mistaking that picture of himself on the meniscus. A stranger could make him happy. He lay like a fallen garden statue, gaze fixed on his image in the water, comparing him to Bacchus or Apollo, falling deeper and deeper in love with what so many had loved so hopelessly. Not recognizing himself, he only wanted himself. He had chosen from all the faces he had ever seen only his own. He was himself the torturer who now began the torture. He plunged his arms deep to embrace one who vanished in agitated water. Again and again he kissed the lips that seemed to be rising to kiss his, but dissolved as he touched them into a soft splash and a shiver of ripples. How could he clasp and caress his own reflection? And still, he could not comprehend what the deception was, what the delusion. He simply became more excited by it. Why clutch so vainly at such brittle figment? What you hope to lay hold of has no existence. Look away, and what you love is nowhere. This is your own shadow. It comes with you. While you stay, it stays. So it will go when you go, if ever you can go. He could not go. He wanted neither to eat nor to sleep, only to lie there, eyes insatiably gazing into the eyes that were no eyes. This is how his own eyes destroyed him. He sat up and, lifting his arms, called to the forest, "You trees, was there ever a love as cruel as mine is to me? You aged voyeurs, you eavesdroppers, among all the lovers who have hidden under your listening leaves, was there ever a love as futureless as mine? What I love is untouchable. We are kept apart neither by seas, nor mountains, nor the locked up gates of cities. Nothing at all comes between us, only the skin of water. He wants my heart as I want his. As I lean to kiss him, he lifts up his face to kiss me. Why can't I reach him? Why can't he reach me? In that very touch of the kiss, we vanish from each other. He vanishes into the skin of water. Who are you? Come out onto the land. I never saw beauty to compare with yours. Oh, why do you always dodge away at the last moment and leave me with my arms full of nothing but water and the memory of an image? It cannot be my ugliness or my age that repels you. If all the nymphs are so crazy about me, your face is full of love as your eyes look into my eyes. I see it, and my hope shakes me. I stretch my arms to you. You stretch yours as eagerly to me. You laugh when I laugh. I have watched your tears through my tears. When I tell you my love, I see your lips seeming to tell me yours, though I cannot hear it. You are me. Now I see that. I see through my own reflection, but it is too late. I'm in love with myself. I torture myself. What am I doing? Loving or being loved? What can my courtship gain? What I want, I am. But being all that I long for, that is my destitution. Why can't I get apart from my body? This is a new kind of love's prayer, to wish himself apart from the one he loves. This impotent grief is taking my strength and my life. My beauty is in full bloom, but I am a cut flower. Let death come quickly, carry me off, for this pain can never follow. The one I love should be let live. He should live on after me, blameless, but when I go, both of us go. Then Narcissus wept into the pool. His tears shattered the still shrine and his image blurred. He cried after it, "Don't leave me. If I cannot touch you, at least let me see you. Let me nourish my starving, luckless love, if only by looking." Then he ripped off his shirt and he beat his bare chest with white fists. The skin flushed under the blows. When Narcissus saw this, did the image return to perfection where the pool had calmed? It was too much for him. Like wax near the flame, or like hoar frost where the first ray of the morning sun creeps across it, he melted, consumed by his love. Like echoes, the petal of his beauty faded, shriveled, fell. He disappeared from his own eyes till nothing remained in the body that had driven Echo. Echo was watching all this misery, remembering how it happened before to her when he ran from her. Her anger blazed, but her pity smothered it. And when he moaned, "Alas," she wept and groaned, "Alas." His last words, as he gazed into the dark pool, "Farewell, you incomparable boy. I have loved you in vain." This return from her lips with sorrow doubled, "I have loved you in vain." And after his last farewell came her last farewell. He pillowed his head on the grass, so finally death closed the eyes that had loved themselves too much. When he entered the land of the dead, Narcissus could not resist it. He ran straight to the banks of the Styx and gazed down into the smear of a shadow, trembling on the fearful current. His sisters, the nymphs of the fountains, cropped their hair and mourned him in a lamenting song, and far off, wandering heartbroken among the hills, Echo sang the refrain. When men came with timber to build a pyre and with crackling torches for the solemnity that would reduce Narcissus to a handful of dust in an urn, no corpse could be found. But there in the pressed grass where he had perished, a tall flower stood unbroken. Bowed, a ruff of white petals, round a dainty bugle center yellow as egg yolk. Yes, it was this quiet woodland flower, trumpeted the fame of Tiresias throughout Achaia.
First to the British people, and then to a broken world.
The success launched the 32-year-old composer into the unusual position of being the first British composer to have written such an enormously successful opera, perhaps since Handel in the 18th century. And this was the first such success setting an English text. The next year, interestingly, he continued, he set an opera on the rather less popular, I don't know if Peter Burns was popular in terms of what he was talking about, and the Great Lucretia was perhaps less popular, but it was very highly symbolic, and that, of course, was based in part on stories of Ovid, which I'm not going to talk about, but it's important that in 1947, that was one of the operas that followed. But 6 years and four further successful operas later, 1951 found Britten working hard on his Festival of Britten commission, the opera Billy Budd, setting a libretto co-written by E.M. Forster and Eric Crozier, based on the novel by Herman Melville. And in addition, Britten was preparing an adaptation of Purcell's opera Dido and Aeneas, which was being performed during the main festival events in May and June. That's rather huge that he was doing both those things. And he really didn't write anything else that year except for a piece for solo opera. As Paul Kilbey wrote in his centennial celebration biography of the composer, quote, he somehow found time to compose six metamorphoses after Ovid, beguiling hand sketches for solo opera, inspired by the Roman poet's long narrative poem, which darted around a monochromatic instrument, creating a brilliant, luminescent tapestry from a single thread. End quote. This work was to be first performed in June by oboist Joy Bowden at the 1951 All-World Festival. This annual art celebration had been founded 3 years previously by Britten and his life partner, Peter Peters, and still takes place each June, based in the fishing village in which they lived, on the east coast of England in the rural county of Suffolk. So why base a solo oboe piece on the metamorphosis of Ovid? Britten was a composer of vivid, expressive music, closely aligned to language. He worked closely with poets and writers of his generation, known especially for his collaborations with W.H. Auden, Christopher Isherwood, Ian Forster, Wilfred Owen, and many others. He didn't actually know Wilfred Owen. He said, obviously, Wilfred, including many old texts. He also read and thought carefully about classic texts, working with others to adapt and set works of Melville, Henry James, Donne, Blake, Eliot, Wordsworth, Keats, Shakespeare, to name just a few. His personal library, which I used to look after as the director of the Britten Peers Library, included collections of poetry and plays, many of which were suggesting Britten may have considered several texts musically, and I would love to have gone to see his collections of Ovid to have looked to see how he selected the six poems. And it's funny, but I can't remember that that's actually been talked about. Going back to all of them. So Britten got his professional start in the early 1930s as a composer on teams creating early documentary films with sound. In this new industry, he worked for the General Post Office Film Unit along with Auden and others who became well known in the theater and film works later in their career. Britten provided music for films promoting the coal industry, the delivery of mail on the overnight train, production of postage stamps and the like. And an essential point about Britten to remember is that this early professional experience was the key to his later successes. The young composer quickly learned how to evoke both the scene, its characters, and its emotional context with, He quickly learned how to evoke a scene, its characters, and its emotional content swiftly changing the sonic scapes. These new characterizations using the entire palette of sounds and silence distinguish his operas, his vocal music, and much of his other music besides, including this poetic work for solo opera. So, just one last point. 1951 was a time when Great Britain was going through metamorphosis, desperately looking to progress through change, but it was also a time when some community members looked back longingly, nostalgically to pre-industrial pastoral, pre-war pastoral times, like that described in the novels of Thomas Hardy, with waving fields of wheat, green hillsides covered with grazing sheep, and with shepherds herding them, contentedly whiling away the time, blowing their flutes or pipes. The solo oboe in the six metamorphoses also looks to that pastoral nostalgia, and as such, written in the festival organizers decided that the first performance would begin in a specially conceived pastoral setting. If you walk from where Britain's home then was, right on the beach at the north end of Old Bay, and mosey north along the sea path as the composer did most afternoons with his dachshunds, through the reeds and along the shingle, after about 2 miles, you come to the picture book seaside hamlet of Thorpe Ness. The village is known for a large, shallow, picturesque lake or mirror inland from the coast. The organizers decided that the first performance of Britain's six metamorphoses would be given from a small boat or punt on the mirror, and the audience would also be afloat in punts all around. The oboe sound would carry over the water, and the audience would listen while floating in the moonlight. In reality, there were practical difficulties that interfered with that idyllic like the music falling away. But let's pretend that we are transported back to Thorpe Ness Mirror, lying back in our punts, listening to a shepherd evoking ancient Rubidian characters, piping the winds of change. So, just to give a little bit of introduction to the music, Britain's Metamorphoses after Ovid offers six miniature vignettes that each show a character going through change. Many of the movements follow a simple narrative shape. The A section introduces the title personality. The B section reveals the metamorphosis in them. And then A returns, but revealing the title personality significantly changed. For each movement, Britain included a brief descriptive phrase, which Yoel has asked me to read to you in conjunction with this performance. So I'll read it.
Thank you.
Phaeton, who rode upon the chariot of the sun for one day and was hurled into the river Potus by a thunderbolt.
Thank you.
Bacchus, at whose feast is heard the noise of gathering women's tackling tones and shouting out of wings.
Thank you.
Arethusa, who flying from the love of Alpheus, the river god, was turned into a fountain.
Melissa Norris and President Pinto for marketing the event. President Pinto tweeted about our event, even quoting Ovid. You can read his favorite Ovid quote on the sign on the display here for more contemporary books about and like Ovid. I also wish to thank Christina Miller, vegan chef at Whole Foods, for preparing the feast for us afterwards. I wish to end by quoting Ovid naturally, who in the voice of Pythagoras, the Greek mathematician and philosopher, says in reference to his rejection of eating of the flesh of animals in Metamorphoses book 15, lines 75 to 78. mente mortale strappe vostre merane fantis corpora. Sunt frughe, sunt decenti a ramos pondre poma suo, tumi dret in vitibus ovai, sunt herbae dulces. O mortals, do not pollute your body with fruits so impious. You have the fruits of the earth. You have apples bending down their branches with their weight, and grapes swelling in ripeness on the vines. You also have sweet herbs. And with that in mind, enjoy the refreshment. Thank you.
I'm